I'd like to start off by welcoming you to the KU's 2017 meeting, and especially those of you who made it to the very early session on the start of our conference. We have a very full schedule planned. I'd like to thank everyone for participating. There's so many talks. It looks like it's going to be a very spectacular meeting. I hope everyone enjoys it. The weather is looking like it hopefully will be quite nice, especially for your outing on Wednesday afternoon. I'd just like to say before we get started that we'd like to acknowledge that we're in Mi'kma'ki, the ancestral and unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq people. And with that, I think I can pass off to our the chair of the math department, Dr. Jeanette Jansen.
Yes, welcome. On behalf of the Department of Mathematics and Statistics at Dalhousie University, welcome to this annual meeting of the Canadian Applied and Industrial Mathematics Society. It's great to see that applied mathematicians from across Canada and beyond have traveled to Halifax, and I hope you enjoy the meeting and have a chance also to see a bit of Halifax. As David said, it's promising to be a beautiful week. So our department, if you went to the reception yesterday, you saw that we are housed in a beautiful building, the Chase Building on campus. We have a number of groups, different research groups, and one of those is in dynamical systems and PDEs, and that's headed by Theo Kolokolnikov and David Iron, local organizers of this conference, and the third local organizer, Paul Muir of St. Mary's University, just down the road, is an adjunct and member and a frequent visitor to our department. I'd like to mention also a former member of our department, who was very active in applied math, especially in numerical analysis. That was Pat Keast, who retired and then last year passed away, sadly. And I was happy to see that he is honored at this meeting with a special session dedicated to his legacy. So looking over the program, I see that you can look forward to a varied and interesting program organized around the themes of numerical analysis and scientific computing, dynamical systems and PDEs, data science, fluid dynamics, and industrial mathematics. You will hear about applications to biology, health, green energy, engineering, climate, and many other things. I especially look forward to the public lecture tonight by Chad Topaz, and I hope that people from the community will come out for this event as well to hear about how mathematical methods can help understand swarm behavior. So without further ado, you have a lot to look forward to, and I won't keep you any longer, so please enjoy your meeting.
Thank you, Jeanette. I guess next we have a few words from the outgoing president, Ray Spiteri.
Mesdames et messieurs, chers collègues et amis, bonjour, je m'appelle Ernest Spiteri. J'ai le privilège de m'adresser à vous aujourd'hui en tant que président de la Société canadienne de mathématiques appliquées et industrielles. Il m'a fait grand plaisir de vous souhaiter la bienvenue à Halifax et à cette conférence. C'est pour moi une grande joie d'être de retour à Halifax et de voir la ville ainsi que le campus de l'Université d'Alhazie. Après de 13 ans après mon départ, je suis toujours aussi heureux de revoir le visage de Tom Mesnilo et ancien ami, collègue et ami ouvrant la mathématique appliquée et industrielle. So good morning, my name is Raymond Spiteri. Ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, friends, it is my privilege to address you today as the president of the Canadian Applied Industrial Math Society and welcome you to Halifax and this conference. So as David said, it is true, I'm only going to be president for another couple of days. Actually, now it's down to about a day and a half. until after the annual general meeting on Wednesday. Yes, for me personally, it is great to be back in Halifax to see the city and Dalhousie campus after almost 13 years away. And it's always great to see the faces of my applied and industrial math colleagues and friends, both young and old. The Canadian Applied Industrial Math Society, or CAIMS, is Canada's national organization dedicated to the promotion of applied mathematics and computational science for solving real-world problems. Since its inception in 1979, CAIMS has worked diligently towards increasing public awareness and support for applied and industrial mathematics both nationally and internationally through education and scholarship. This meeting represents the apex of the Society's activity each year. The main events are the plenary talks, at which we have internationally renowned experts give specialized talks in their research areas. The prize talks, at which we celebrate the accomplishments of our colleagues and students for their outstanding contributions to applied mathematics research. And of course, the roughly 120 research talks presented by our members. We also have an NSERC information session and an industry panel and networking event later today. And Jeanette has kindly also talked about some of the other things that are going on at this meeting. Our much anticipated annual general meeting is Wednesday and comes complete with free box lunch. And the banquet, which caps off the non-technical aspects of the meeting, is on Thursday. So you won't want to miss that for sure. I would like to thank our hosts at Dalhousie University for welcoming us into their city and taking on the huge task of organizing this meeting. Thanks to all the hard work of David Iron, Theo Kolnikov, and Paul Muir, and the rest of their team, we are set to kick off an exciting week of sharing information, ideas, and that unique sense of camaraderie and energy between researchers in applied and industrial mathematics for which this conference is known. Thank you.
Assume all the rest are fixed. So, for example, imagine that you have the Navier-Stokes a lambda is the Reynolds number, or f might represent a nonlinear elasticity equation, and lambda is the amount of load that you apply. And so I'm going to vary this parameter lambda, and I'm interested in understanding how the solution to this equation varies as I vary this parameter. And so just to be concrete, so one example of a problem that isn't so interesting to me is the Poisson equation, where as part of my residual, I take minus the Laplace u minus lambda f equals 0, and then encode the boundary conditions in the definition of these power spaces. And this, of course, because it's linear, can only have 0 for infinite solutions, depending on the null space boundary conditions, whether this is in the range. Whereas a nonlinear equation, if you introduce, say, a semilinearity, this can indeed support distinct solutions, not trivial distinct solutions, as you vary this parameter lambda. Indeed, we'll see this example later on. Okay, so before I launch into describing a new algorithm for this task, I thought I should justify why do I and we care about this at all. And so the argument that I want to present to you is that if your physical system supports distinct solutions, then this is crucial for understanding it, manipulating it. And so to this end, I have a nice example from real-world practice, and that is from the world of aeronautical engineering. So I solve PDEs because it's fun, but many people solve PDEs because, well, they want to figure out what's the result of some physical experiment without actually having to go to the trouble of doing it because it's too expensive or because it's infeasible. So one such community is the community of aeronautical engineers who are interested in understanding the flows around aircraft. And because it really matters whether their simulations are correct, they have a charming tradition of challenging each other. So what someone will do is they'll take a wing, this is the NASA trapezoidal wing, and they'll put it in a wind tunnel, this is the wind tunnel at NASA Ames in California, and they'll do an experiment. They'll take some data of what the flow looks like, and then they'll publish the configuration, but not the results. And so then they send the configuration around, and everyone gets 6 or 9 months to plug it into their solvers, and then do it blind, and then they all come and meet and compare the results. Okay, and so this story is brutally condensed from a much more interesting paper by these gentlemen at Boeing. Okay, so there was this challenge, this NASA high-level prediction challenge, and so the people at Boeing took it up and they plugged the configuration into their standard workhorse CFD solver, and it converged very happily to this solution. And they were happy with this, they did all of the usual things that engineers do, they did grid refinement studies, and in the end they said, oh, this is, we're happy with this solution. However, at the same time, they were also developing another solver, a different solver with a very slightly different discretization, and they plugged in the same configuration, and then it converged to this solution instead. So quite different, and the difference in lift from one to the other is about 15%, which really matters if you're taking off from Heathrow. And so this confused them, and they initially thought, well, this must be a bug in the second code is under development, you know, and so on. But in the end, they came to the conclusion, actually, that this was simply a system that supported two distinct solutions. So you could convince yourself of this in several ways. So you could do grid refinement studies, check that this persists under discretization. Okay, well, that's reasonable enough. But the main way that they persuaded themselves was that you can take this solution, the second solution, and plug it into the first solver, and the first solver will converge to something that looks indistinguishable to this, and vice versa. You can take the first solution and plug it into the second solver. And so this raises a really interesting and worrying possibility. Right? So suppose that I have a nonlinear PDE that supports two solutions, and I don't know this fact. So here are the two solutions and some boundary space. So I start my nonlinear solver from some initial guess. I drive it to convergence. I converge to this green solution, and then I can do everything that I should. I can do grid refinement studies. I can even compute a posteriori error estimates, and they'll check out because it is really a solution. And then I finish, I'm done, I'm happy, and I publish this as my prediction for what's going to happen when I take off. But for whatever reason, nature chooses the other stable solution. So if you're interested in the business of predicting what physical systems do, you really need to care about whether it has more or less. And so it's not just me who agrees, so I like this quote from Venkat Venkatakrishnan, who's one of the main people doing CFD at Boeing. He's trying to convince his bosses that they should spend more on supercomputers or less on wind tunnels. And it's an extreme source of worry. This has serious implications for the use of CFD and more generally of scientific computing in predicting physical systems that are governed by nonlinear. So that's why I think this is an important one. Okay, and so again, I expect with this material, this section, many of you will be familiar to it because it's a great tradition of bifurcation analysis in Canada. But just in case, I want to explain what the current state-of-the-art algorithm is for computing bifurcation diagrams in order to contrast it with what I'll propose. And so this algorithm of arc line of continuation and branch switching is very famous and very successful and was worked on by Keller and there were many, many other people that it's too many to list. And this is one of the workhorses of engineering computations and engineering departments. So this is a bifurcation diagram. So on the x-axis, I've got my parameter lambda that I'm varying. On the y-axis, I've got the PDE state. Now I'm really thinking of this as a point in a Banach space, but I can draw things in Banach spaces. I can only draw on two axes, and so I'm going to compute some functional of the state to plot that instead. Okay, so what this says, what this diagram says, is that up to here, there's one solution, and then at this critical value of lambda, it bifurcates in a pitchfork, and now there's three solutions. So suppose that this is the structure that I want to discover, but I don't know this yet. So I start with an initial datum here. So I have one solution on the branch that I'm investigating. And so what do? I use continuation, it might be naive continuation or arc line continuation, to go from this value of lambda, which is easy, to this value of lambda, which is harder. And then once I've gone that far, I can use this value as initial guess for the next continuation step and so on. And if I just did continuation, I would explore the branch, but not have maybe not discovered the fact, the interesting fact, that the number of solutions varies between this continuation and that continuation. Okay, so I need some device for detecting that a bifurcation has occurred, and the traditional one proposed in the initial algorithms was monitoring the sign of the determinant of the Jacobian. And this is easily available if you're doing an LU factorization. It's less easily available if you're using problem solvers. There are alternatives that have been proposed, but somehow you need to detect and observe the fact that something interesting has happened between here and here. But suppose we have such a detection device, then we need to go back and compute this bifurcation point. And a typical way of doing this, there are many variants in all of this family of algorithms, but a typical way of doing this is to solve an augmented system of equations that describes what it means to be a bifurcation point. You solve for the u and the lambda together that satisfy the equations. Once you're here, you've got information about the null space of the Fourier derivative at that point, and then you can use it to switch branches, and then you get points on all of these emanating branches, and now you have one. Right now you can do continuation, and you can explore those as far as you like. Okay, so this bifurcation structure of having a pitchfork is intimately associated, of course, with the symmetries of the equation. So with if you wanted a structure like this, you should have an equation that has a Z2 symmetry, something reflective. This solution here is a reflection of that solution up there. What happens if I break the symmetry? So if I have different boundary conditions on the left or the right, or I consider buckling in a case where I'm opposing gravity in this particular direction, is that the bifurcation diagram separates. So the connectedness of that pitchfork depended on having a particular symmetry, and that symmetry is very easily broken. It only happens in the sense of measure zero. And so this is a much more typical picture of what a bifurcation diagram looks like. And if I apply the previous algorithm, well then I'll only ever compute this lower branch without doing something extra. And so I'll miss the fact that these solutions exist. Okay, so that's the first disadvantage of claiming that the algorithm only computes, and it only attempts to compute, the part of the bifurcation diagram that's connected to the initial datum that you give it. Now, of course, there are devices for you to vary the parameters to induce the symmetry to explore the bifurcation diagram, and then you break it again, or you start with different guesses. But those require a lot of knowledge of the analyst, a lot of expertise, a lot of interactivity. The second problem is that, well, this algorithm requires many different subproblems. I have to solve the original PDE, you have to solve the augmented arc length system, I have to detect bifurcation points, I have to solve for the solution at the bifurcation point, switch branches. There's lots of different pieces to this puzzle, and making all of those scale for very large discretizations when you can only afford to use Kronos solvers can be rather difficult. It's not impossible, people have done it, but it's been a lot. And so what I'm going to propose is an algorithm that overcomes these claimed disadvantages. So the first is that the algorithm I propose will naturally compute bifurcation diagrams that are disconnected even without you supplying any extra initial data. So this is much better if you don't really have a good idea of what's going on. And the second advantage is that if you have a good preconditioner for your original problem without any augmentation, without doing any augmenting or anything like this, then I can do the entire bifurcation analysis. It requires nothing other than the solution in the steps. And so if you can solve the Ford problem, you can scale as far as you want. Okay, so that's where I'm going. So the new ingredient, well it's not a new ingredient, it was proposed in the 70s, but the new ingredient we're going to add to this bifurcation analysis links is something called conflation. So let's see what that is. So I'm going to fix a parameter lambda. So now I just have a fixed nonlinear problem and I'm looking for as many solutions of that as I can find. And what am I going to ask for? Well, I ask that the residual now is Fréchet differentiable, which is not too much to ask. Later on, I'll relax this assumption and go to things that are really semi-smooth. And then I'd also, for now, like a solution R that's nice. So I've got f bar equal to 0, and it's nice in the sense that the Fréchet derivative of the Jacobian is not semi-smooth. So really what that means is that the solution that we have is isolated. You can put a ball around it, and there are no other solutions nearby. Again, I'm going to relax this later on, but for now, let's just consider the easy case. So I have a problem, and I have one solution to that problem. What I'm going to do is I'm going to construct a new residual G, mapping to and from the same spaces, with the following properties. So the first is that if you find a solution of G, it's also going to be a solution of F, a distinct solution of F, and vice versa. Right? So there's a relationship between the solutions of G and the solutions of F. So I can apply a root-finding algorithm to G, and if I do find a root, I know it's a root of F. And the second one, in words, is that Newton's method, if I apply it to this new problem of G, will never converge to the solution that I've deflated away the solution that I know. And so I might not converge, but if I do converge, I'll find something new. So the key idea here is that given the same data, you need to specify an initial guess to derive Newton Kantorovich anyway. Given that same data, I'm going to try to find many solutions, not just one. So let's draw this pictorially. So imagine I have a PDE that has three distinct solutions, these stars. I'm going to start my nonlinear solve from this initial guess, conveniently located in the middle. So I draw Newton Kantorovich, and just as normal, nothing fancy yet, and then it converges to this blue solution. Then I deflate the solution, and now I can start, even though I can start from the same initial data, and if I converge, I'll converge to something new, say this green solution. And then I can keep going. I can compound this process, so I can deflate that, start again, converge to this red solution. Now, typically, I don't know how many solutions this PDE has, so I have to search. So I search again, and then I can't search forever. I put an upper bound on the amount of work I'm willing to do, so I say I'll do 50 Newton iterations. If I haven't discovered anything, then I give up. And in particular, because Newton is not Newton has this property that even if there are solutions, they may not be found by Newton. You cannot conclude there are no more solutions. There may be other solutions here in the corner that we didn't find. We might have found if we did 100 Newton iterations, or maybe we couldn't find them. I don't know. But so be it. That's that. It's not a magic bullet. Okay, and so that's what we want to achieve. How do we do it? Well, you apply a nonlinear transformation to the residual that you have. So you've got your original residual, and now I'm going to apply this M, which is a deflation operator, to my residual. And the basic gist, this is a simplification of the definition, there are other properties, but the essential one that I want is that if I take any sequence that converges to the solution that I already know, if I look at the norm of this deflated residual, sorry, that should be math algae, then the norm of the residual blows up. So the limit is bounded away from zero. And what this property means is exactly that Newton won't give you that sequence again. Because Newton is looking for sequences where the residual goes to zero, and if you can make it look as if the residual is bounded away from zero, then Newton won't return that sequence. Okay, so that's the property that we want. And how do you achieve it? Well, it's remarkably simple. What do you do? You multiply your residual by a scalar, just one real number. And so here I take 1 over the norm of u minus r to some power p, carefully chosen, plus 1. So let me explain what these two terms do. So the first term is the one that's giving us the deflation property. So this is what's blowing up as U approaches R. And I can choose the P to blow up faster than the rate at which F goes to zero, and thus enforce deflation. The second plus one, while it looks trivial, is actually crucial. So this is for the opposite limit, if you like. If I take U very, very far away from R, this distance is very large, 1 over that distance is very small, and so this deflation factor just converges back to 1. So far away from the solutions that you already have, you're just operating with the same nonlinear problem that you always did. Right? It's a local modification. This, if you're familiar with deflation, many of you will have read Algar and Georg, or perhaps the book of Seidel. They briefly do discuss deflation, sort of a half a page on it. The key thing that they miss, this plus one makes all the difference between the algorithm working or not working. Because if you miss it, the deflation factor goes to zero far away from a solution that you already have, and so then you might only get two or three, and then it blows up far away from the solutions that you already know, and then it just gives garbage. So this is what makes it your 10 solutions rather than one. Okay, so this idea, of course, has history, all ideas do. And so I suppose the first relevant reference for us numerical analysts is the book of Wilkinson, the algebraic eigenvalue problem. So Wilkinson didn't have the QR algorithm. He was trying to compute the eigenvalues of matrices, which means the roots of the characteristic polynomial. And so he was using an idea that's familiar to every schoolboy and schoolgirl. If I give you a polynomial, P, and I give you a root of it, R, then you can construct a new polynomial by dividing P by X minus R. So he was systematically investigating this in terms of rounding errors, and I don't know the root exactly. Then this paper by Brown and Gearhart in 1971 had the essential idea that you could put this operator in to make sure that the limit blows up, but they didn't have the shift, and it didn't actually work all that well. So they could find two, maybe sometimes three solutions, but it never was particularly robust. And then, so we have been working on this, so there's a group of us at Oxford and Fredden and Oscar Bergeson and many PhD students and collaborators around the world. And we've done lots of things. So we've extended the analysis to bound spaces, so you can be sure that this works on PDEs in a continuous sense, so you enjoy mesh independence and discretization. This shifting is crucial for robustness. We use it for continuation, as I'll explain momentarily, and lots of other things besides. So more or less, everything in the talk up to now hasn't been new. Everything in the talk from now is new. Okay, so now that we have deflation, let's see what we can do to analyze the bifurcation structure of this same problem. So again, I start with an initial datum. I do continuation. I go from here to here. In this case, I'll just use simple, naive parameter continuation. I won't actually need to treat folding points specially, as we'll see later on. So I just do naive continuation from here to here, another naive continuation step from here to here, and at every continuation step, I activate the device that I'm about to describe. So what do? I've used this as initial guess for this problem. Right? So I fixed the value of lambda. This is the problem that I'm interested in. Well, I can deflate this solution and start from this initial guess again. So I deflate this solution and then start from this initial guess. And now if I converge, I'll converge to something else where the bifurcation diagram intersects this vertical line. And if you do this close enough to the bifurcation point, you expect that the solution is still close to the initial guess, so you can guarantee convergence. I can deflate again, find another solution, and keep going. And then I don't know how many solutions there are, I do a search which fails, and then I go on. Crucially, notice that here, I haven't gone anywhere near the bifurcation point, and you can compute that later on if you like. You can compute stabilities and all this, but you don't need to. And in particular, the same idea works just fine even if the bifurcation diagram disconnects. Right? So suppose that I started with this initial datum and I converged first to this solution, deflated it away, I can then find this one, deflate that away, I can then find that one, and it doesn't matter whether the bifurcation diagram is connected or not. Okay, so that's the first advantage that I claim, that it computes disconnected bifurcation diagrams. What about the scaling? Can I solve this? Can I do this for problems with billions of degrees of freedom? The answer is yes, but what we have to figure out is how do we solve the deflated problem? So we've constructed a new nonlinear problem. I need to compute solutions. Okay, so now I've lost all the math pals inside because I've discretized somehow, I don't mind how. And so this is the Newton step that we were solving just during Newton development. 3D. So I've got the Jacobian of my discretized residual. I'm looking for an update delta U on the right-hand side of that minus the current residual. So this is the Newton step that I assume that I can solve. So I can solve this up to a discretization to the trillion degrees of freedom. Excellent. I know how to do this. Okay. Well, so once we deflate, we modify the problem. So we change the residual, and we'll change the Jacobian as well. So now on the right-hand side, I've got the deflated residual, and I've got the deflated Jacobian. And now this is the linear system that I want to solve. So I can solve this one. I need to solve this one. What I'm going to do is I'm going to express the solution of this linear system in terms of the solution of the one above. And so if we look at what the residual is, okay, so I have this scalar. This just maps to a real number, multiplying the original residual, which is a vector. So this is a vector, scalar, vector. Then if I apply the Leibniz rule, I can figure out what the Jacobian of this guy is. And so here I have a scaling of the original Jacobian. This is sparse, and I know how to solve it. So that's a term that I like. And then I have this term, which is a term that I don't like so much. So this is a rank one outer product of two vectors. So this is the original residual multiplied by the derivative of the deflation factor. And it should really be a surprise that the deflated Jacobian becomes dense, because what we've done is we've multiplied every component of the residual by a number that depends on every component of the solution. So there's a dense and this density and sparsity value, but it's something that we can really get a handle on, because all of us know if you have a nice matrix plus a rank one update, you can apply the Sherman-Morrison formula. And if you apply the Sherman-Morrison formula, it turns out that something beautiful happens. There's a cancellation in it. And the reason for that is because buried inside this G is the original F. G is just a scalar times the F. And this F is also the vector that shows up in the rank one update. So something cancels, and you're left with the simple fact that the deflated Newton step is nothing other than a scalar multiple of the original Newton step. So what do? You apply your existing Newton code, you solve the original problem, which you can do, and then you compute this tau, which is just a simple function of this, the update, the deflation factor, the deflation residual, and then you scale by that. Right? So it's really just a few dot products and scalars of the vector by a real number. And so because of this extremely simple structure, what that means is that if you have a good preconditioner for your original problem, you can scale this as far as you can. Okay, so that's all very nice in theory, but it doesn't really work. So let me try to convince you with some examples. So let's take a look at the nonlinear residual I had back in the introduction. So this is an Allan Kahn equation, which my applied colleagues reliably tell me models binary algebras. And so here I'm going to impose some boundary conditions in this problem. So this is taken from other work. So this particular problem has minus one on the top and bottom, and plus one on the left and right. Okay? And so if you start your Newton iteration from just the neutral initial guess, from the initial guess zero everywhere, Newton will happily converge to this solution here, where the positive and negative materials are equally balanced. But then, if you deflate away the solution, you start from the exact same place with no prior information, you'll converge to this solution, where the negative material dominates. And then you can deflate this, and then you'll converge to the positive solution, where the positive material dominates. So what happens, of course, this is the minimization of a non-convex energy functional. These are the two minima, and this is the saddle point in between. And so it seems to work. Okay? And these are all the solutions to this problem. Permits at this parameter value. That's nice. Okay, another classical example of here. If you're doing bifurcation analysis, everyone has to do an elastic, right? So I'll do a simplifying elastic level, right? So the perfect boundary conditions. So I've got a cantilever that's affixed to a wall, and I'm crushing it with the force lambda at a certain critical value of lambda that the cantilever will buckle. But it prefers to buckle down because I live on Earth and there's gravity. So this mu is fixed, and this is the parameter that I'm doing continuation in. And so this, I thought I would show you the actual software that I use. So there's a software package called DEFCON that I write that does the bifurcation analysis. But it's all built on top of Phoenix, so you just write the residual of Phoenix and then it goes and computes the bifurcation diagram. And so what I'd like you to observe here is that even though, so this is just an ODE, I'm actually just using 1,000 degrees of freedom. Perfectly adequate. represent the PDE solutions, and so you might not be able to parallelize that usefully. But I'm here, I'm using four different cores of my laptop over there, because when you're exploring a bifurcation diagram, there's many, many things you can be doing in parallel. You can be continuing different branches, you can be looking for new solutions from solutions you already know, you can be computing the stabilities of solutions that we can have, and there in about 40 seconds we've computed the entire bifurcation diagram of FlyEx. And so notice that even though this bifurcation diagram is disconnected, we still managed to explore it. And so all of the results that I'll show are down with this. Okay, so these examples are well understood, right? We all know what the solutions of the elastic look like. Can you use this to do something more interesting, to discover something new about some symmetric problem? And I hope that the answer is yes. So this problem was suggested to us by Andrew Fenton. So in the book of Bender and Hornsack, they discuss, in this famous book about singularly perturbed problems, they discuss this beautiful example of a nonlinear singularly perturbed problem, Harrier's problem. And the reason why they spend 10 or 15 pages discussing this equation is because its solution is absolutely fascinating. Right? It exhibits a great variety of solutions, and indeed many of them, not all of them, many of them are amenable to boundary layer theory of the time. Right? So this was a great success. But they make an interesting claim that as you take epsilon down to zero, the number of solutions lowers divisible by four. When you think from a bifurcation perspective, how could that be? What kinds of bifurcation could induce four new solutions at every step? So we thought we would go as a go. Okay, so if you apply standard arc length continuation with branch switching, this is the bifurcation diagram that you'll get. Right? So it's easy to see for large values of psi. So here I'm going from right to left. This is the easy case, and here it's getting harder as I reduce the epsilon. But in the easy case of large epsilon, there are two solutions. And so suppose that we know those two solutions, and we drive arc length continuation and branch switching from there. This is the bifurcation diagram that arises. But then if you think, okay, well, maybe I'm missing something, and we'll apply a deflated continuation, then you discover this inner set of solutions that are disconnected from the other ones. So there's four new solutions, one arising at a fold and a subsequent pitchfork. And then you keep going, and then there's another set of four solutions arising at a fold and a pitchfork, and another, and another, and another. And it turns out that this equation has a beautiful solution structure. It's nested like the layers of an onion or a Russian doll, right? Within each one, there's another four, and another four, and another four. But notice what's interesting is that actually there are large regions of the interval where Bender and Hornsack's claim isn't true. So inside this, between the fold and the pitchfork, there are only six solutions, which isn't divisible by four. So their statement was, I wouldn't say it's wrong, it was carelessly stated, but it's true asymptotically, because you can see that they come closer and closer together. And so, you know, I'm a numerical analyst, and I've got this graph, and so I said, great, that's it, these are the solutions of the equation. But what's nice is that, well, you know, you can really learn a lot about the solutions from this. And let me just show you the sorts of things that you can learn. What distinguishes the different branches? Well, if you look at them, so this is solution one, this is solution two, I'm going to take one from here and one from here. And it turns out, okay, this has no interior maxima, this has one interior maximum, this has two, this has three, and indeed that's exactly what distinguishes the different branches, the number of interior maxima. That's interesting. And then, okay, well, let's take a look at the four solutions that are on a given fragment of this diagram. And so two of them, this one and this one, are symmetric. These are the ones that arose ab initio in fold bifurcation. And then at the pitchfork, it turns out that one of these guys either shifts to the right or shifts to the left. And then as you drive the parameter of epsilon down to zero, you can better see where these are going. Some of these will become boundary layers, and some of these will become interior layers. So you can learn an awful lot about the solution structure of this equation, what's going on with the solution if you drive epsilon down to zero, but I can't really explain, right? I can't prove to you that this is what it looks like. But that's when you go ask John Chapman, who's an expert in asymptotic analysis, and it turns out that if you can tell him what the answer is, he's able to prove it for you. Right? So there we go. So now we have a complete asymptotic description of all of the solutions in this equation, and indeed it has a beautiful and simple structure. So the pitchfork bifurcations occur exactly at these, well not exactly, at these parameter values. It's a fixed constant, and then for the first one it's n equals 1, for the second it's n equals 2, and so on. And so if you compute one of the bifurcation points by solving the Morse dense system. So I believe these numbers to 8 digits, and you compare it to the asymptotic estimate, the relative errors are strikingly small, even for the very, very first bifurcation points. When you're assuming that you have an infinite number of oscillations, still it works for one oscillation, which is kind of amazing. And the fold bifurcations happen, again, it's the same story. Now there's a nice asymptotic formula and a nice asymptotic description of what all of the solutions are for any value of epsilon. So you can ask this for epsilon 10 to the minus 6, what's the 103-second solution of what we have? Okay, so another area of physics with many interesting solutions is in liquid crystals, which Scott McLaughlin is going to give a longer talk later. So here we are minimizing the Frank Racine energy for a polysteric liquid crystal. And I don't know anything about liquid crystals, I just, you know, they give me the PDE and I glide through what the solutions are. But it turns out that there are loads of interesting solution structures. So this is a representative example of the kinds of simulations we've been doing. Here we're modifying this cholesteric parameter from in UC. There's an extraordinary explosion of solutions for some values of the parameter. There's a great frustration in the liquid crystal. Now, this means that there are many different ways of trying to satisfy mutually incompatible constraints. And so these are the kinds of diagrams that we can get. And indeed, here you can see that there are many, many stable solutions. The dark black ones are the stable configurations. And with these, you can draw pictures like this. Each one of these is a rendering of the solution of the directed field of the liquid crystal. And you can try to map out exactly what do the bifurcations mean in terms of the physical region. Very interesting. Okay, so these are some examples of PDEs with nice isolated solutions, and PDEs are smooth and differential. What happens if these assumptions don't hold? So let's go back and relax some of the theory that we had earlier on. And so the first one I'd like to talk about is brand new. It's the first time I've ever spoken about it. And I'm going to ask, what happens if I solve a PDE that has a symmetry, a continuous symmetry? Suppose that I solve a PDE on a disk. I can take any solution and I can rotate it around the disk, and then it's still a solution. There I have an infinite number of solutions. So if I apply what I've done already, what will happen is that I'll find one solution, I'll deflate that, but then if I run again, I'll find the solution right next to it, and find the solution right next to it. I'll find hundreds of different representatives of the same orbit. And this is really bad, right? When actually I can generate all of these trivially from my knowledge of the symmetry. So really, the philosophical shift, I suppose, in this work is that what I'm looking for when I'm trying to ask the question, what are the solutions of PDE? I'm not really asking for the solutions, I'm asking for what are the group orbits? What are the distinct orbits of solutions of this equation? And so the key idea that I'm going to pound out is that you can construct a deflation operator that respects the Lie group of symmetries of your equation. You can systematically or semi-systematically do this. And so if you have one representative of an orbit, you can deflate away the entire orbit. Okay, so this is best done with an example. So this problem is the Grosz-Palevsky equation, and indeed I think there are several people talking about this later on today, so I'm quite excited to see it work. And so this problem was brought to my attention by some physicists at UMass Amherst, who said, well, this has a great many solutions. We know some of them. We suspect there are others. Please take it. And so if you go and do your Lie group theory and you compute what are the invariants, the generators of the symmetry group. So one of them is this. So you can take a solution phi, and for a fixed theta, you can multiply every point by e to the I theta, so you can do a rotation in complex space, and then it's still a solution. And then if you plug this in to the theory that we have of how do you design deflation operators, what it will tell you is that the deflation operator you want is going to look at an invariant of the solution with respect to that symmetry group. So even if I rotate in complex space, the magnitude of the complex number doesn't change. So if I look at the field that at every point is the magnitude of the complex number, and then I compare those, this will be invariant, this will respect that symmetry group, and so you'll eliminate the entire group orbit. Okay, that's not the only symmetry group that this problem has. You can also do a rotation physically. So if you solve this on a disk or a square, you can rotate the solution around. And so this is what the generator looks like. And then if you plug that in to the theory, you get something maybe a little less familiar. So it says, please compare this transform of the solutions Well, what does the transform mean? So you give me a psi, and I'm going to give you a psi tilde, evaluated at a point x, y. What do? You take the circle around that, that includes that point x, y, centered at the origin, and you average the original function over that circle. So you're looking at the radially invariant part, if you like, the part that's invariant under rotation, and you compare this. So then this will deflate the entire orbit of symmetries there, and then you ultimately you combine it. So this is what the deflation operator looks like for this entire symmetry. And if you go ahead and now apply this deflation operator to this equation, then you come out with some really striking and beautiful results. So I left it running for, I don't know, a month or so on my workstation at home. And then it came back with 21 distinct orbits, many of whom were new, that hadn't been seen before or discussed in the literature on this problem. So this problem has a long history, and indeed many of the branches are amenable to various kinds of analysis, but all of the pictures that I show were new orbits that hadn't been systematically discussed or identified before. Sorry, this one. And so these pictures are, of course, of the magnitude of the complex one. And they're really rather beautiful. It's amazing the distinct structures that this equation permits. There are many, many different solutions, all for the exact same PDE with the exact same parameter values. The other thing I want to point out is that, again, I claim ignorance of this equation. I'm not a specialist in quantum mechanics. They told me the equation, we figured out what the deflation operator should be, and then we ground out the solutions. And so the only thing that I had to supply was an initial guess to discover the first branch, the ground state. But since this is very well known, almost any guess will work, these orbits were discovered with essentially no user supply data. So here we discovered something physically new without actually knowing all that much about the physics of the problem. Okay, so the last extension that I want to discuss is to relax the requirement that the residual is smooth. So earlier on, I demanded Fourier differentiability of the residual. What happens if I lose that? Well, so there's a very important class of residuals called with a property that's called semi-smoothness. I don't really have time to explain what that is, but the important thing about semi-smoothness is twofold. So first of all, you can reformulate variational inequalities as root finding of semi-smooth residuals. Right? So now I can consider variational inequalities as well as systems of equations. And the second thing that I want you to know about semi-smooth equations is that they're just smooth enough to define a sensible Newton-type method. Right? So you can define a semi-smooth Newton method on these problems. And if you go ahead and do the analysis, it turns out that you can prove under the same assumptions for which semi-smooth Newton converges, you can prove that a deflation operator does indeed enjoy the deflation property. And so you can eliminate known solutions of semi-smooth equations, and in this way we can consider systems of inequality. So a simple algebraic example of this, I discussed this first in Oxford, Nick Gould is a famous optimizer there, he gave me this problem. And the reason why this problem is interesting is because its central path is pathological. So the standard approach for solving this problem involves a barrier term and doing continuation in the parameter in front of it. And that doesn't really work very well for this equation because the central path is interesting because it's not convex. So you can reformulate this optimization problem as its optimality conditions, reformulate those as a semi-smooth residual, apply a semi-smooth Newton method plus deflation, and this is what it looks like. So here, this shaded region is the Fiesel region, and these are the contours of the original function that I was trying to minimize. And so first, semi-smooth Newton converges to the saddle point, and then it converges to this minimum after deflation, and then it converges to this minimum after deflation. So in this way, you can systematically identify distinct stationary points of optimization problems, even with inequality constraints, and then post-process them to see which ones are minimized and which ones are the best ones that I have. And this idea also applies to PDEs, so I'll show one last final example of this. So this is the mathematician's sketch of what engineers do with their time, right? So engineers design pipes, so we'll figure out how should we formulate this mathematically. So suppose that I have a domain of height 1 and width delta, and I'm going to design a pipe that connects these inflows here to these outflows here. So you're told by your manager, the engineer to your left is going to give you these inflows, I guarantee that, and the engineer to your right demands that you satisfy that you supply these outflows to him, And I want you to connect these inflows to these outflows in the most efficient way. I want you to lose the least amount of power, but I have a constraint for you that it can only weigh so much. So you can't occupy the entire domain, you can only occupy a certain fraction of the area. Okay, and so this was formulated and analyzed by Borbal and Peterson, and the mathematical formulation of this is the following. So ignore this for the moment. Here the flow is just governed by the Stokes equations, so it wouldn't look dramatically different if you consider Navier Stokes instead. The way that I'm going to represent my pipe is with a scalar field rho, and rho is going to be 1 where there's pipe, and 0 where there is no pipe. Right? So I'm solving a PDE constraint optimization problem for a scalar field that tries to capture where should the pipe be. And the pipe takes effect through this term that modifies the permeability. So where there's pipe, the flow can go through, and where there's no pipe, there's a great resistance to the flow. So this is what sort of approximates the idea that there's a pipe. The energy and the power dissipated in the fluid is governed by, is given by this expression here. So this is the power dissipated to the porous medium, and this is the power, this is the velocity to viscosity. And then I have inequality constraints. So at every point, I can only have, well, ideally I want only 0 over 1, but I consider a continuous relaxation of the problem to solve it. So I demand that rho at every point is between 0 and 1, almost everywhere. And then this is the one that makes it really hard. This is the one that says I can only occupy a certain fraction of the domain. So you take this PDE constraint optimization problem, take a look at the optimality conditions, you reformulate that as a semi-smooth system of equations, apply semi-smooth Newton with continuation, and then deflate it, and this is what you get. So the first solution to this, this problem looks like this. So here the red represents pipe, the blue represents no pipe. And so here I have two distinct pipes that connect the two distinct inflows to the two distinct outflows. Straightforward, right? But it turns out that there's another minimizer, which is this one. So this is the monkey wrench configuration, where you pay a price in energy to join the two pipes, and you are to join the inflows, and you and then you pay a price in energy to fork them at the end, but what you gain is that the pipe in the middle is thicker, so you lose less power this way. Right? It turns out that depending on the aspect ratio, this is a better or worse minimum than the other one. And indeed, this aspect ratio, this is the superior design. Okay, and so to conclude, so I hope I've convinced you that distinct solutions in PDEs are ubiquitous. They really show up in physical problems. And they're important. You need to know about them if you're trying to solve them, try to figure out what's going on. The deflation is a powerful and, I would claim, undervalued technique. So the previous discussions in the literature of deflation are rather dismissive. But I think really it's just because they missed the shift. So if you shift, it works much better. Deflated problems can be solved efficiently. So if you do have a good preconditioning, you can scale the buildings to produce freedom. And that there are lots of interesting applications. Understanding nonlinear PDEs, in conducting bifurcation analysis, in solving complementarity problems and variation inequalities, and indeed in large-scale PDE constraint optimization with inequality constraints. With that, I'll conclude. Thanks very much.
Sort of you have three variables, right? X, Y, and I, or so. You have two supersymmetries you found sort of one basically in the area in which you used the elevation operator, what would you use if you had more symmetries so that you wouldn't end up in the area to formulate this elevation operator?
So that's a very good question, and I don't have a good answer for it, but I'd love to discuss it further. So these advances in, or these initial efforts in understanding how to deflate entire orbits of symmetries are really brand new. I've only been doing this for the past few weeks. I'm by far an expert in Lieber theory, so I'd love to discuss this some more. So I think so long as you can deflate, so the thing that worries me about this, which may or may not pertain to your question, is that when you start deflating orbits, you always have some collateral damage. So with these invariants, you're not just deflating away all the rotations of your solution, you're also rotating anything that has the same rotationally invariant signature, right? And so I think this is an unavoidable fact of trying to deflate away orbits rather than individual solutions. But maybe we can be more precise. But I'd love to discuss this more.
I'm just wondering about your algorithm in cases of multiple solutions with higher multiplicity. Is it just changing the value of p that needs to happen with that? So if you had like some sort of double root situation or whatever.
So that's also a good question. So one way to do it is to, when you find a solution, to analyze what its multiplicity is, which is somehow expensive and not very desirable. But it turns out the algorithm has a nice self-correcting property, right? So this is even visible in polynomials. So imagine that you take x minus 2 squared, x minus 3, and then I tell you that x equals 2 is a root, well then still the deflated problem has x equals 2 as a root. It will find x equals 2 again, and you deflate it again. So at the cost of some refining of the same solution, eventually sort of it deflates it enough times that it's no longer there, so long as it's a finite multiplicity, and then you move on. But yeah, so I tend not to worry about this. It's cheaper just to keep searching.
Consider whether the similar algorithm can be used to reconstruct the invariant manifolds for the related to the basis of attractions of individual solutions?
No, I have not. So I don't even know how you would begin to explore or describe these, but it's a really interesting question. I haven't thought about it at all. I don't even know how you would even begin to plot it. How do you describe?
Normally, you have a solution and then you integrate backwards in time. Higher dimensional problems is always a challenge.
Sure.
And so maybe we can talk about it.
Yeah, please.
So the example you started off with is boring. So I'm assuming that's all you meant.
It's the Mills average number you said.
So you wouldn't expect that to be two solutions,
would
you?
They're currently struggling in the community with how to deal with this. What are the protocols that we should teach engineers in order to try to make sure that it's robust? So in the paper, they propose various different things like starting from lots of initial guesses or systematically modifying family conditions. And so I think that the continuation of a much more systematic way of investigating this, but I haven't managed to convince them of this for the main reason that they don't solve grams with using. So the solvers that we have in these equations are very specialized, and I've never been able to re-implement one myself or get my hands on one and think about how you can deflate with these systems. That still remains an aspect.
Thank you very much.
Oh, that's very kind of you.
Thank you.